to be here, everyone. I'm going to tell you something about REST and Apache Kafka. That's why REST in peace, Apache Kafka is alive. Yeah, live from the Netherlands. I will present to you REST in peace back. Apache Kafka is alive. So imagine, it was a nightmare to be a developer in the 90s. You were running application on different machines that talk to each other, and that was really a problem in the back then days. Especially if you had different hardware, you had different operating systems, and even programmers used other sockets and wrote entire protocols, stacked themselves, or they program. Didn't talk at all. So it was like hell. So it was a kind of graveyard. So it was really difficult to talk to different machines. But wait, there was something new. There was Corba to talk to other servers. First, it was only C. And later also, you had Java. In a nutshell, I'm not going to talk about Corba, of course, but it was sending messages to a broker, having a contract, and it proxy it to a server. But yeah, you can imagine that was very time consuming. If you look at network latency and you have a contract, and if you need to change it, it was very difficult to do that. Especially if you have different departments, you need to change the contract and that kind of things. It was not very handy, and it was also complex. So we moved on, and we moved it even in JDK 11. Nowadays, you also have SOAP. It was going public when there was a solar eclipse in the Netherlands. Yeah, it was easier to use. But again, you needed contracts between clients and servers. And yeah, it's good, it's strict. XML they're using, or we are using with SOAP. And XML is very complex for people if you never work with it. So people really wanted something easy like JSON. So yeah, it's still heavily used. Also, if you look on where I programmed different assignments, you see still you have SOAP, but it changed in. So hi, my name is Koot Turk. I'm working for Blue for IT at the Rabobank. I like going to the Utrecht Jerk. I'm talking about Kafka and Micrometer. I'm married, I like trail. I'm coming from the Netherlands, Geldermals, so that's the flag of Geldermals. And contact me through Twitter if you have a question or something, or leave a tweet. Will be really awesome, thank you. So what do you want to learn today? It's easy. We are comparing REST with Kafka, and I will tell you when to use REST and when you can better use Kafka. So yeah, and we are going to create a payment application with consumers and producers. And if you have time enough, we are even going to stream it. So that is really nice. Let's go. And if you have questions or something, please let me know, or the moderator, or leave it in the chat, and the moderator will give a heads up to me. You have different styles of communication. You have time driven, like you can see it like a cron tab. It's time based. If something's happening on your computer on a certain time, like something spooky or something's happening, and that's time based. Mostly if you have problems, by the way, that's really difficult to search because you have a trigger somewhere in the cron tab. Don't do it. You have something like a painting. It's request driven. You made it and then it's done. And you hang it on the wall or something, request driven. It's like a get request through HTTP. And you have something like events. There's a spider crawling on the table and it's doing something, and you need to do something with it because you're very scared of it, or you have three styles of communication. And I don't going to talk about time, but I'm going to talk about, of course, the REST with events, right? So REST, it's stands for Representational State Transfer, and was created by computer scientist Roy Fielding in 2000 even. And Yeah, the difference between REST, for example, with SOAP is that SOAP is a protocol and REST is an architecture, and same with event-driven architecture. REST is based on HTTP, so you can do GET, POST, PUT, PATCH, DELETE, and that kind of stuff. It's all based on HTTP. And yeah, REST is very handy because you can handle plain text, XML, HTML, and JSON. The reason why REST is more and more used nowadays is because it's very easy. It's less complex, not strict typing like XML, easy to use. Parsing of JSON is not intensive. And REST was used for the first time in 2000 even. And after 2006, Amazon used it. It was a little bit becoming the default. And nowadays you see a lot of REST services, right? But yeah, maybe there's sometimes you need a change there, because sometimes you don't even need REST. And I will show you in a minute. I'm going to share my screen again. So if you have 1 minute, please, I'm going to share my other screen. Screen two, I'm going to share it. So this can be gone. Perfect. So is it readable like this? And otherwise, give me a heads up so I can do something about it.
Looks fine.
Yeah, okay, perfect. So imagine you have a cool REST service. You have on your assignment, you have someone raised a hand, Yannick, is it correct? You can unmute yourself if you want, or okay, I think it's good, I guess. So you have a REST client. So this is I'm going to show you the controller. So we have one controller here. It's we use Lombok. Yeah, I could use even Lombok, of course, but of Kotlin. But now I choose just to show you some Java. We have a service, a payment service, and it's a REST service. Like you see, you have a GET, you have a POST, and you have a DELETE. And mostly you see something like this. You have a package with controller, domain, exception, and service. Yeah, something similar, or DTO or whatever. And
From the chat, excuse me. Can you make it a little bit bigger, maybe the front?
Well, yeah, sure, no problem. Increase font, something like this. Fonts. Six. So much is this is not the wrong one. Normally, if it's that is the shortcut. Perfect. I forgot the shortcut. So excited to speak. So you have a control. Is it good like this? I guess so, right? And otherwise, let me know.
Yeah, it works.
Nice. So we have a POST mapping, huh? And we have a service, and if it's it can return okay, or it can return an internal server error or something, or bad request, just what you want. It's just an example. It can be, of course, much better, but it's just an example. But we have a service, and if you look in that service, it's a little bit painful, because mostly you're doing a lot of stuff. And that's not always needed. Yeah, of course, this is a little bit too much, just to make my point. I have here six services where we're talking. I'm creating a payment application, and what we need to do if we want to create a payment, for example, at the bank, you can also make it an order or something. But you need to check your balance, right? So if you have not enough balance, then you throw an exception or something. And then the next step is we need to check the payment on fraud. Is there something wrong with it? And if yes, then we need maybe an exception. Oh, it's again, it's a thing like this. And yeah, if it's not valid, then you send alert with fill or something. And then the next step, with every transaction, you get points, bonus points or something. Some banks are doing that, and then you get some reward at the end or something. And then the next step is, as a programmer, I want to add some analytics for payments. And then I'm going to process my payment. And yeah, that is really like you, it's really a lot of things you need to do. Like here also, like if it's an internal transaction, for example, you're going to process as internal, and it can be external, and you send an alert. So that's a lot of things to do. And as a customer, you need to wait and wait and wait till your request is over. So this is a good example of just separate things. Like, it's good to use REST, of course. Yeah, REST is awesome. But you can also think something about Apache Kafka. And yeah, I will tell you something about that later. Yeah, it can be much smoother. So I'm going to again share my screen. Let's not stand here, maybe differently. Look at this. Share it. Of course, I think like this. So yeah, we talked about REST, right? I showed you some code. Of course, we're doing some live coding later, so be prepared. So what I was saying, it's sharing the right screen, the bigger screen, I guess so, right?
Yes.
Okay, perfect.
Yes.
Nice. So it's, yeah, we want to have something less complex. We're doing a lot of things. We're calling a lot of services. And maybe it can be easier. Maybe we can separate things. Maybe we can separate some things to different application. So yeah, that's the question. And of course, it can be faster. Like some things you can just do it in background, and you can do it asynchronous, like checking on fraud, sending alerts, for example. And there's a good example for it, for example. Nice. And yeah, it also need to be fault tolerant, right? Like yeah, payments, you don't want that payments are lost, for example, because that will be really awful. And if there's something happening with a motorcycle, for example, yeah, that will be devastating, right? Because yeah, and if it's fault tolerant, then you can maybe reprocess it if something going wrong. And if you look to partitions, if one partition is gone, you want to scale it up, for example, the other one is taking it over. So we want to also be online always. And what I said, you want to replay it. Like, yeah, you want to see different steps. Maybe so you get an exception somewhere, and yeah, some things are crashing the whole system because there's a timeout somewhere and you need to check it. And with replayability, you can start from the beginning. Like in the beginning, you had an incoming message, and you can just reprocess it again. So yeah, nothing is lost. Only it's, yeah, it needs to, you have some, you need some replayability. So yeah, we need Kafka for that. Kafka is extremely useful. You have three flavors. You have Apache Kafka, the basic. So you have a consumer and a producer, and you can send messages to it. And you have, for example, streaming. And streaming can also be very handy. I will come to that later. And you have Connect to connect to, for example, to different source systems. Like you have a CRM system or a database, and you can connect that things. So you have three flavors there. Yeah, what you can see here is in the middle, you have Kafka. It can be a topic, it can be different things, it can be a stream. And if you look at the Kafka produce and the consumer, you just produce one message. For example, you have a REST endpoint, and that one is putting some things on a topic. So you're going to produce it to a topic. And the other side is taking that message and is consuming that. And yeah, that's really so nice because yeah, you win some time there, right? Because you can just do it in the background. Kafka will deal with it. You don't need to worry about clusters, that kind of things. It's just going to reprocess. And then you have streams. Streams is some more advanced and it's even more useful if you want to have different streams, a pipeline connected to each other. For example, you have a payment system or something and you need, for example, some information from a system like some settings or something, or that kind of things. And yeah, you can combine them and you can combine the keys, and at the end you have just one object. So you can, like the streaming API in Java, you can use the Kafka library. Take some water. And you have Kafka Connect. It can, you have a source database, you can connect it to the system, and you can also reach the target database if you want to save it to something. But I'm not going to talk about Kafka Connect source, but I'm going to talk about Kafka Produce Consumer, and if you have time, some streams. So what do you need? Some awful image, sorry about that, by the way, but yeah, it's a theme, right? So you need to download Apache Kafka. It's really easy. You go to kafkaapache.org, quick start, and you just follow the manual. It's easy. Just download it. You can start it with a binary or shell, and you can also start Zookeeper. And Zookeeper is more like a service that check your Kafka cluster. It's a centralized service, and it's maintaining some configuration data, and it's just checking your health of your clusters. You can also use Excel, for example, on top of Kafka, for example, just to have the messages. It's a racing car, and you can use Excel as a schema registry, and you can easily maintain your messages there. Kafka is, by the way, using Avro. So for the message, so if you want to search or send a message, it needs an Avro message. It's a kind of format, and you can maintain it, for example, like a tool like Excel, or just do it yourself with some commands. So what we said, it can be much easier. For example, you have a REST service, and that REST service is going to put some things on the Kafka cluster. It's going to produce a message. You have a payment system, like here in the middle, you have a yellow. And that payment system, or that you are going to produce something to that topic, right? And some other application is taking care of some other things, like checking the balance maybe, checking the types, is it credit card or is it a debit card, or that kind of things. It's doing all kind of checks. And then it's doing asynchronous things. So you can just wait if it's okay or not. You can go in REST service. You can just give an okay back, and in your transaction, you can see if it's correct handled. For example, it's just an example. And the payment system, or that application that listens from the topic, can also connect to other topics, right? Like can check fraud, can check some analytics, rewards maybe, it can sending alerts. And it's always doing on the background. It can be it's asynchronous, right? Excuse me, sorry. So let's continue with some live coding here. Sorry again for the image. So back to the live coding. So we have a REST package, and we can just create, for example, a package with Kafka. And like we can create a class, like a Java class. We call it payment producer, for example. And we have an application, of course. Just going to do a copy paste this handle. It's just a Spring Boot application. And we want to create a producer, right? payment consumer, sorry. So yeah, the first step is you want to make it, of course, a component. Maybe you want to make it a required args controller. Just going to use Lombok there. And then the next step is maybe you want to add some SLF4J or something. Just to log some things. So for example, we have a Kafka template. We're going to use Kafka template, and with that template, we can, for example, send, we need to use the producer. Ready. First, send something to a topic, like here. Oh, a little bit lazy. Yeah, and there we have the what I said, the template. And with that template, we can do some things, like we can send some messages. So what we can do is, of course, we do the log.info, for example, and log something useful. And then we're going to use the Kafka template to send something like we need to send something to topic and with the payload. So yeah, this is the only thing you need to do to produce something to a topic. So yeah. Kafka topic. And also we want to consume something, right? So I'm going back to the consumer. And here you have a record, for example. You have a private string record. You have the Kafka listener. With that Kafka listener, you can listen to a certain topic. Set the record, of course. This dot record is telling you something. And maybe you want to set it also. You can also do it. You want maybe to get the records. So yeah, that's it for consuming. What we are doing here is yeah, we have a consumer record. It's going to listen to the topic with Kafka listener. It's from it's from Spring also, so it knows, hey, I need to listen to the topic payments with group ID something. So yeah, that's really it. So it's really easy. So what we are going to do now is we're going to start Kafka. It's really easy. Just you have a bin and shell with some server properties. That's now, oh, because it first needs a zookeeper. First, we need to start zookeeper. And then we need to start Kafka. So we started Kafka and Zookeeper now to check the cluster. So yeah, it's just a demo. Of course, you can create a JUnit test with, for example, test containers and doing the same kind of things, only a JUnit test. But you can also do it just live like this. It's more exciting, right? So next step is just to create some tests. Just create a test from here. Like here. So yeah, we have the integration test. I already did something. It's just a Spring Boot test with a Kafka listen again. It's listening from the topics, like created something with the payload topic. Of course, we need topics, right? So, yeah, what we have here is a test consumer. It's going to send something to the producer. A transaction 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and yeah, you have assert equals get record, and I already auto-wired the things like the consumer and the producer, so I can even use it. So I have a value payments value here. So yeah, let's start it. We want to produce something, right? So we first send it, and then we are going to consume it. Something's not where we are. This is the topology. It's not going to work. Just do it like this now. Just do it again. And here we have a Spring application test. And it's, of course, always failing, right? And what is going wrong here? Message methods. It's always happening, right? Application. It's a good one. Just going to use other thing. Just also have it here. This one, always a picker. So we have the integration test here, and I could just run it again. And here you have the consumer, but this time it's saying, hey, it's not, nothing received, but that's correct because we have a different topic here. Because we are sending to payments and we're consuming from another topic. So yeah, be aware of that. Okay, now it's good, thank God. Always the demigods, right? So what we did now is just sending something to a topic with the transaction and read it. So we are expecting that it's this, and it's correct because I'll be sending this. So that is really useful. You can do it from your REST service, for example, just to send a message and you just use the producer like I did in the test and send some payload. Now I'm only sending a string, but you can also use an after message. It's a kind of message you can send. I don't have a demo for that, but yeah, this is just a simple one. Maybe next time. So that's really nice. You also have the streams, and it's even more powerful. It's not producer consumer, but you can use a stream. So for example, you have a K stream, and we're going to enable Kafka streams with an annotation. And again, we have a stream payment topic, which you can again change it to payments, for example. And yeah, what we're here doing, for example, what I want to say is streams is very powerful because you can combine some things, you can do functional programming. So, and yeah, that's really awesome, right? So at some assignments where I worked on, we heavily use this, the case stream. Like you can filter on it. What we want to do, for example, in this case stream is we have a payment and we want to check it on fraud. So a certain IBAN is blacklisted, for example. And it's again, a simple example. You can make it as much as complex you want to do, right? And yeah, you can compare the IBAN, for example. And we're going to map it to an AFRO, for example. A fraud, for example. I'm just creating an AFRO here. This is a kind of AFRO message. Like this. This is a kind of AFRO message. It looks like a little bit like XML, but it's less strict. You don't need to have like this string can be 8 characters or something. Yeah, you don't need that. So yeah, it's easy to use. So again, we have a fraud stream here and we combine it with the payment stream. So we are combining now two streams with each other. And that's really so nice of it because you can just compare some things. You take one from another stream and the other stream and chuck, combine it like a pipeline. So yeah, if you have the chance to use it, just try it. It's really useful. It's a really powerful tool. You can, what I said, do functional programming like the Java Streams API. It's a little bit, looks like this, that's a little bit similar. You have to filter map values, flat map, and that kind of things. Yeah, that is useful. So yeah, if you have a chance, just use it. And of course, we can also make a topology test. But yeah, for that, you need to do something more. You need to spin up the stream, like you have a pipeline and a topology, and that you need to start it with a test drive with all kinds of properties you can use, like configuration, application ID config, schema, registry URL, that kind of things. If you're using Axio, you can point to the other things. So yeah, there's a lot of code, but what we are doing here is just spin up the stream, and we have some input topics, like we have a payment topic and a fraud topic, and yeah, you need to say, hey, it's a string and we need to serialize to an AFRO, that kind of things. But yeah, out of that, it's really easy. This is just a JUnit test, so you need to spin up something, right, just to show you something. But yeah, if you don't need to use it, if you use it in your application, you need to close it. And again, you can also use test containers. It's also very useful. Some people are already using it, I guess. It's very useful. So here I created a test. I have a payment, and some evil person want to book something to his IBAN, and the bank see, hey, that IBAN is blacklisted. So stop it. like this, you can do some evil input or something or whatever you want to check on fraud, and you can run it. And again, of course, what we have, unknown topic, payments topic. payments, maybe then, again, never change before a demo your topic names. And then it's checked. So what we did now is just filter out that one item would have a fraud. So, like I said, it's it's very useful. What's left to say about this topic? No, not really much. You can make it such as complex you want. Be aware of that, because you need to keep it simple and you need to keep it readable, and that's something you really need to watch out. Like I've shown you in the topology. Here you define your streams when you started. You can do all kind of complex things, but be aware, just make it so simple as readable as possible, because this can be easy, really complex, because you can do here, you can do a left join, and then you can do a right join, goodbye, and then it can be ta-ta-ta-ta-ta, and it can be easily complex. So keep an eye on the readability. That's the most important things if you want to maintain such applications. So back to the awful images. So in a nutshell, when to use REST if it's a simple application. You don't need to do a lot of stuff. It's just request response. You only need HTTP. And it's synchronous. It's very common use for public APIs. And if you have a simple application, don't use Apache Kafka. Use it when you want to go asynchronous, for example. And if it's simple, just leave it simple. That's the best way to maintain also an application. But it can be heavily used, for example, if you use big data, right? If you have a stream of transactions, that can be very useful then, right? If you have big data, it needs to be quick. And then mostly you can do it asynchronously. Like you have a lot of transactions and you need processes async, then you're quicker. You need to check it to fraud what is said. Apache Kafka is scalable. So if you have a problem, then it will scale up. You can define it with strategies and that kind of things. You can replay it, so nothing is lost. You can set an offset. It's fault tolerance. So it's what I'm saying, it's a spin up a new cluster or a group or something. It's take the other one, and then it's just going to continue. So, that was in a nutshell the difference between REST and Kafka. I want to thank you. Sorry for my throat. My Twitter, GoTurk77, and on GitHub you can find this live demoing session. And if you need to want to have or want to know some more things, reach out to me. I'm there. So if there are some questions in the chat, please. This is your time. Back to the moderator.
Hi. Currently, we don't have any questions here.
Okay. Then I have a question. Is someone already using Kafka or seeing some opportunities maybe for to use it, for example?
Now we get questions in the chat.
Perfect, Marcy. You need some time to think about questions, but yeah, nice. Yeah, I can read it first. Let's read it. Oh, this is just I'm still sharing that. Oh, to the questions to see it. Where are the questions? Yeah, maybe you can let me know what the questions are. It will be even nice.
Yeah, sure. One second. How would we approach contract testing and API documentation for message-driven architectures?
Public documentation. Mostly we are creating that kind of things only in REST endpoints like Swagger. I don't know. Like in REST, you have you can use Swagger, right? You have public documentation, Open API or Swagger, and mostly we are, for example, maintaining some applications, and we don't need that documentation like Swagger. But I don't know if there's a way. It's a good question. Let's find out together later on. But you have metrics, so but that's something else. But so you can also use Actuate, for example, to check metrics, how many messages are processed and that kind of things. It can also be helpful, but that's still not documentation. But let's find out. Thank you. Good question.
The next one was, what do you think about KSQL?
KSQL, I never use it. We are using, for example, KStreams. We're using that kind of things. Never worked with KSQL, so KStreams. Yeah, we're mostly using with that. Also need to look it up. Sorry.
Then we have a question. I am using JMS Active MQ in Wildfly. What would be a motivation to switch to Kafka in this context? JEE, JDI, Wild.
Kafka is more like a whole system. It's a whole platform behind it. Like you get a lot for free. It's scalable. You have things like replayability. I don't know if you also have that in ActiveMQ or something, but that are things you can think of. You can start from a certain offset. Like if you process some message and then you want to go back to one, it's possible. It's saving it, the messages, to a log. You can give an retention time, for example, on it. Like I want to have 2 weeks of messages on that topic. That's really useful. I'm not a star with ActiveMQ, but I can imagine like this whole platform behind it. It's more than only a queue or a topic. It's a whole system behind it, and that makes it very, very nice.
Okay. The next question was: observability? It always seems harder to trace and follow async messages-driven request responses.
Yeah, that's true. But you need to think about proper monitoring, right? I have also another talk about it on the software with Micrometer. You also need to define your metrics. Like you need to define, for example, some metrics. It can be to track, for example, you have logging statements, of course, you have still have them. If you have an exception, you're going to log that to a system like a Splunk or something or whatever. But you also need to define the metrics with a micrometer. Not every team is using that. It's not used a lot. It should be used more and more and more, because especially for this kind of asynchronous things, it's very useful. Like maybe you want to, in Grafana, there's a dashboarding tool. For example, you can read the values you are writing from the code. Like for example, I want to write maybe the time, maybe it's a time I want to process the performance of a certain actions. Maybe I want to have a counter on message, how many messages I have processed. Or maybe I want to even, if you have a connection also with a REST endpoint, you can even have a metric with exceptions. And I find it very powerful that you see all kind of exceptions in one view. Like you can monitor in it. Like there are 20,000 exceptions on null point or something. Yeah, that will be really devastating, right? If you have a null point, so you need to fix it as soon as possible. But if you can see it that it's 20,000 times occurred, then you need to think, hey, that may be urgent. And that kind of logging or metrics, creating metrics, you need should be aware of, and that makes life much easier if you think about it. It's not only logging, by REST it can be okay, but even then you need should create metrics, but yeah, you should with Kafka, otherwise it will be really a problem. Yeah, it's a good question.
Yeah, I think the last question we can do is, why shouldn't we use Kafka for ETL?
An ETL is just a big data system or something. It's also
ETL stands for extract, transform, and load.
Yeah, that is also. Yeah, I don't have any experience with ETL or something, but it's also big data. I don't know the system behind it, but what I said, you have a whole system behind it with Kafka. You can even ask at third party like Confluent or Axel or that kind of companies to have the clusters maintained and that kind of thing. So you don't need to do that only creating topics with a simple GUI or something. That's also possible, right? It's not only the messaging. It's more than messaging. It's a whole platform behind it. I don't know ETL, but yeah, I don't know what ETL does. It's a system behind it. I don't. Yeah, let's have a discussion after it if you want. So maybe we can compare.
We have 1 minute left. I think it's that's enough questions now. We have to finish this track now.
Yeah, sure. Again, many thanks everyone for joining this session. Hope to see you in the chat or maybe at another conference. And I wish you everyone a pleasant day. See you around.